Praise the Lord. I'm excited already. Isn't that wonderful? To know that, right, if we should rest before Jesus comes, if we die in Him, right, we hear that voice of the shepherd. We're going to come out. We may rest a little season, but what eternity is sure. Praise God for that. And we want to make sure that it is today, right? Before we leave this place, there's no reason for us not to be anchored, right, in that rock of eternal salvation. And make sure that your salvation is secured in Jesus. That's where it's at, isn't it? We're glad you're here. And by the way, those who join us from week to week, we send out a lot of DVDs and things and audio tapes. And we always like to welcome them in and encourage them to make sure they get their Bible and turn with us in the passage of Scripture. And we encourage people, by the way, when you're at home, is to, make sure that everything else is turned off and turn your phone off and everything else. Because, the enemy tries to disturb when we study the Word of God. And so we need to really focus. We live in such an hour, we must focus on eternity because it's just around the corner. What we have is very short time here on this earth. And then what? Oh, friend, we need to get ready because Jesus is coming. I pray that you brought your Bible. Sometimes it's a difficult habit maybe to get into, but I don't want it to be for you. And if you forgot it today, so be it. But I'm going to encourage you from week to week as you come, bring the sword. Bring the Word of God with you and follow along so that you know what is truth. Everything that is spoken from the pulpit, because it is a pulpit, doesn't mean it's true, does it? You have to search the Scriptures, the Bible said. You have to try the spirits, the Bible said, to see whether these things be so. Today I want to talk about a subject that's near and dear to my heart. And I hope that you've experienced it, by the way, and that maybe you are experiencing it today as well as I am. Transformed by God's grace. Transformed by God's grace. What does that really mean to a Christian? How is it that we can be transformed to be like Jesus? How is it? What does transformed really mean? And what does it really mean when you talk about grace? A lot of biblical definitions and other definitions about grace. But what does it really mean when it's applied to our hearts and to our lives? Friend, to go through your experience as a Christian and not knowing whether you're in a saving relationship with God, there's something wrong. We need to know that we have that anchor. We need to know that we have that hold upon the Savior. We need to know that His blood is sufficient enough to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I'm so thankful the Scripture is clear today that if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The Bible didn't say a little bit of unrighteousness. It said all unrighteousness. And today, dear friends, every one of us are in the same boat. If anybody here thinks they're any better than anybody else, I'm going to ask you to rethink it. Because there's no one here any better than anybody else. I don't care what your life has been like or what you have done or how many times you have done it. If you've asked Jesus to come into your heart and to your life, He's going to cleanse you. He's not going to quiz you. He's not going to try to challenge you. He's simply going to say, as He did that woman that was caught, He said, go your way and sin no more. That's the kind of Savior that we serve today. And He wants us to have clean hearts and clean hands. That's who He's coming back after. If you turn with me in your Bible to 1 Thessalonians in the New Testament, it's just a small passage of Scripture, but how powerful it becomes as we read it. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 3. Somebody say you've got it. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse what? 3. Verse 3. Now, Paul wrote these words. I believe that Paul was a man of God. I believe that Paul was ordained by God. I believe he was called by God for a specific mission. And so Paul penned these words, and he did it for me. And I think he did it for you. As we read them together, let's see what you think about it. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 3. The Bible says, "For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, and ye should abstain," the Bible says, "from what?" From fornication. Notice the first part, how powerful it is, and the heart's cry of Paul to each one of us. He's saying this is the will of God. You realize how important it is, all of us today, that we walk in the will of God? Amen. You know, a lot of Christians today are professing Christians. I want you to listen to me. They profess or they say that they're Christians, but they refuse to walk in the light of truth. Friend, you're only professing that you are. Jesus is going to say to that group, "Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I don't know you." So it's more than lip service is what he's asking for today, isn't he? God has said, "This is my will for you." This is God's plan for us as his children. And so no other plan will really do. And so when we look at the life that God wants us to live, many times I believe that we're challenged. We're challenged that, oh, it's too difficult. Ooh, boy, that's going to mean giving up something I like. Whoa, I won't get to go there anymore. And so the battle with self rages on. But God says, this is my will for you. Notice this, even your sanctification. What does that mean? The subject title is Transformed by God's Grace. So we're looking at transformation and we're looking at grace today and how they can come together to play a part to help us to gain victory in our life. Is there anyone here today that wants or feels they need some more victory in their life besides me? Oh, yes. Listen, friends, we may be heaven bound, but we're not there yet. And there's a lot that we might be going through yet in the near future that we haven't been through. And God wants us to understand the word, hide it in our hearts and in our minds that we might not sin against Him. God's will then is sanctification. John 17:17 says, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is what? True. Thy word is true. Part of sanctification, by the way, is knowing what is truth. Is it not? This is what the Bible said. When God sanctifies something, that means He sets it apart. It's for sacred use, is it not? That's the same thing He said about the seventh-day Sabbath, if you remember. It said God blessed and He sanctified, or He set it apart for holy use. And He said, I want you to be set aside for holy use. And my will for you is what? God's will is that you be sanctified, that you be set apart, that you're different in this world. And all I hear most generally, and it's sad many times for our young people and sometimes for us who are older, that we want to look more like the world and to act more like the world. And we need, oh, be careful, Kenny. We need the designer type clothes. Because if we're not designed, you know, then, well, you know, some of us are unkind if we're not designed. Now think about it. And others are unkind to us. Well, where did you get those? Well, I know where I got most of my clothes when I was growing up, from the Goodwill. Is somebody with me? That's where we got most of our clothes, or they were hand-me-downs. And then it was okay to roll your cuffs up, you know, three or four different times. Some people do it now, and it's kind of considered style, I guess. But then when you rolled your cuffs up three or four times, that means that your brother had them on before you and his brother before him. And all those holes were there, wasn't really meant to be, but now they put them there, and they charge you more money. See, God challenges us to be different. He wants to be our designer. He wants to design my heart and design my mind, that like Paul said, that it would be Christ's mind. And I tell him, Lord, this old pot here, it needs to be remade. It needs to be in the hands, right, of the potter, and to reshape me and to remold me. But many times we want to follow the ways of the world, and God says, no, I want the sanctification. Turn with me quickly to the book of Romans chapter 5, verse 20. We mention the word here, sanctification, and I want to just mention grace here just a moment, please. Romans 5:20. Now we'll put these words together, see how they can come into our heart, into our mind, into our life, and help to educate us and train us for heaven. Romans chapter 5, verse 20. Are we there? The Bible says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. Now here we go. But where sin, what? abounded. Notice this word, underline it if you haven't. Grace did much more abound. Just exactly what we've been talking about here, regardless of our life and our lifestyle in the past, right? It doesn't matter. Because the Bible said, but where sin abounded, and it just didn't label sin as 5 pounds of sin, or 25 times we've sinned. It said where sin abounded. In your life and my life, it abounded an awful lot, when leaps and bounds, is somebody with me. But where it abounded, where it grew up into a big heap, where it seemed insurmountable, that we couldn't get over it, we couldn't gain the victory. And it seemed like that heaven wasn't going to be our home. Listen, the devil wants you to think about that this morning. He wants you to look at your life and say, I am so sinful, I am so dirty, I'm so rotten, I'm so unsavable, that I might as well just give up. And you know what? Many people have. But friend, you know what? You're savable material because of Jesus Christ. That's His work. That's what He did. That's what He does. He's making the unlovely lovable and lovely. The unreachable where He can reach them. He's making the unkind kind. He's making the hateful, you know, thoughtful and sweet. I mention those things because those are all my characteristics. See, He's still working on me. And I hope He's still working on you. You know why? Again, because you haven't arrived yet. You're not in heaven yet, are you? And so day by day you're tested and you're tried. But I thank God today for this passage. It said where sin abounded, where it surrounded us, it smothered us, it captivated us, it encircled us, it enchained us. It said grace did, notice this, much more abound. Not just, you barely made it, boy. You just barely got out of this one. However, how much sin, however broad and deep it is, God said grace did much more abound. He covered it up and He destroyed it. And it's no longer a part of our hearts and our lives. Transformed by God's grace. As I read that passage of Scripture where it said the will of God, this is your sanctification. Passage makes it very clear, at least in my mind, from the very beginning, even before the foundation of the world, this was God's plan for me, that I may be pure, that I may be holy, that I may be acceptable to Him. You see, we have to claim His merits today, or heaven's not going to be our home. We have to claim His life because we've all fouled up, we've all messed up. And how desperately we need to claim these things. And not only claim them, dear friends, but praise God for them today. So do we give the devil any credit? No, we're praising God because we were the unsavable ones, it seemed like, in time in our life. And God said, no, they're not. God always sees something good in every individual. He sees something worth saving. Did you know that? When everybody else says, well, they're not worth saving. Look at their life. Look at that. You know, it's time that we quit looking at everybody else. What do you say? No one will ever be saved in God's kingdom because they were beholding each other. He said we need to behold Him. As we behold Him, if I be lifted up, will draw all men unto me, the Bible said. And it's interesting that word sanctification, just sanctification. It's only used 5 times in Scripture. Now sanctified and sanctifying and so on is used many different times. But sanctification, it's so important and it's so powerful. But you know, it only takes one stick of dynamite to make a blast. Did you know that? And so sanctification is a word that blasts out that God says, this is my will for each one of you. But friend, we have to cooperate. Do you know that? We must cooperate with God. Let me just run over a couple of things with you. Now, if you defined, if you could today, and I'm sure many of you have good thoughts about it, if you could define, or you could just say what transformation means to you, what would be a definition for you? Well, we'd probably all have a little different definition of what transformed or transformation really means to each one of us. It's interesting, and I hardly ever hear this said, but that it could be. It doesn't mean I hear everything. But when you say transformation, people say, well, that means we're just transformed. That means we're changed, isn't it? It does. Paul said it, the things that we once loved, I what? I now hate. That is proof of transformation. Do you know that? If you still love the things that you loved when you're in the world, before you met Jesus Christ, you have not been transformed. That's just proof. But really, when you say transformation, you're saying born again. Think about it. We need to be born again. Our thoughts need to be born again. Our eyes need to be born again. Our ears need to be born again. And they need to be centered on the things of heaven. It's a new birth in Jesus Christ. And you know, we need that new birth. We must have that new birth. Jesus says if we don't, we're not going to enter the kingdom of God. Unless we're born of what? John 3. Born of the water and the Spirit, we're not going to go to heaven. And so some of us say, well, I've been born of the water, but where's the Spirit? Where's the Spirit in the life? Where's the Spirit in the church? Where's the happiness that should exist in the church? Where's the peace that should exist in the church? When the slightest winds blow, we fall apart. We lose everything. And when we have a hold of Jesus Christ, even though the winds blow, we're still secured on that rock. And it doesn't mean we won't get beaten, slapped around a little bit, abused and misused. But it means we're still going to be there. Some of us may be knocked unconscious for a while. It's such a blow. You still follow me? But when we first come to, we're going to be, whoa, am I still fastened to the rock? Am I still fastened there? I'm down, but I'm not out. When the slightest wind blows, many people, first person they give up on is God. How sad. If He's your rock, you cannot give up on Him. You need Him more than ever before. How desperately we need Jesus in our life. We must be fully persuaded in our mind now that we have that relationship with Christ. I want you to be fully persuaded today. Friend, if you're not fully persuaded that you know Him, today's the day that you get to know Him. You don't really have to pass a test. You don't have to start praying out loud. You don't have to read a bunch of passages of Scripture. But by faith, you can seize the hand of God right now, by faith. And you say, God, forgive me, right? Lord, forgive me. I want to be part of the family of God. And God will say, you know, being part of the family of God, that's nice. I want you to come in. But you know what? God does have some tests for us. In everyday life, every day, this week, I don't know, how about any of you? You've been tested? I've been tested a little bit. Ooh, glory. Brother Jacob and I, we're raising our hand. We're the only one. My brother said one time, I'm just going to raise both of them up. You know what I mean? All month, ever since you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. When you got serious with God, then the devil got serious. He's not serious. Listen, the devil don't get serious with you until you get serious with God. Does that make sense? When you're playing a Christian, he knows you're playing a Christian. He knows exactly what's going on in your life. He really doesn't care. Got them. Don't worry about them. Let's go land on Brother Jacob. He's trying. You follow? At the enemy. Let's leave these here. We've got them. Let's go work. But we must get serious. We was praying this week before we were taping the program. We came to the conclusion that it was time that we really got serious with God in prayer. I'm talking about serious in our relationship with Him. Not just coming to church once a week and saying, well, yeah, well, yeah, amen, praise God, this was good. But I'm talking about down on your knees. I'm talking about willing to deny self. I'm talking about just getting down and saying, God, whatever Your will is for me, let it happen. I want to be saved in the kingdom. I can't let You go. Time is too short. The world is falling apart. And hundreds and thousands, millions of people are professing. But yet they're not willing to be obedient. Jesus simply said, you say, you love, you love, you love. He said, if you love Me, keep My commandments. And the world said, we don't have to keep the commandment. Then we don't love Him. That's what the Bible says. It's not this little preacher saying this. See, we take things personal rather than read them from God's Word. If God said, if you love Me, then you keep them. Don't say that they don't exist anymore. If you love Me, then keep them. It's real simple. And yet we put up such a fight. Because we enjoy our lifestyle. We enjoy some of the things that this world has to offer us when they're not any good for us. Where does this transformation take place? If I'm going to be transformed by God's grace, where does it begin? Absolutely. It begins, number one, in your heart. But your heart has to be open. You can't be closed. You know, people have so many preconceived ideas about everything. Well, my dad taught me, and he taught me, and they taught me, and this is the way I've always been. Friend, we need to get over that. It may have been good enough for grandma and grandpa, but it may not be good enough for you. Because you know better. To him that knoweth to do good and doeth not, to him is what? It is sin to him that knoweth to do good and will not do it. This is the probationary time in which we have to live, and you don't know when it's up. I don't know when it's up. It could be up for you going home today. Did you know that? Your book could be closed, and how do you stand with God? See, that's the way every day has to be. Not, well, I better make sure I'm prayed up. I'm going to get in the car. Well, yeah, pray when you get in the car. You better believe it. A lot of people die in their sleep. Do you know that? Where are you going to spend eternity? Now remember, it's heaven or what? Or hell. That's one of the, I told you before, a long time ago, that's one of the finest sermons I ever heard in my life. By a new babe in Jesus Christ. Didn't really hardly know the Bible at all. But he got up to preach his first sermon. And it lasted every bit of 2 or 3 minutes. The young man grew up with Danny and myself. Name was John Hawkins. He's dead now. He had a heart attack. He died. Left a family and children. They started coming to church because he began to see something in these other fellows, you know, in a family they didn't have. So he adopted the Sheltons there on Warden Street. That's mom and dad. This is part of my family because my family, I don't even know my dad. He's now, oh, he's gone. I live with my grandmother. When he became about 20, 25 years old, he accepted the message. God's called me to preach. Well, wonderful. He got to preach his first sermon. Boy, he opened his Bible. He read one passage of Scripture. He said, today you've got to make a decision. Today you've got to make a decision for Jesus. Because today it's either heaven or hell. Let's pray. You know what? It reached my heart. I never forgotten all these years. He didn't have to go through some theological explanation of all these things. He brought to my heart and to my mind, Kenny, you're going one place or the other. And if you really desire a certain place you'd like to go, that should be the desire of your heart. You will receive it if it is the desire of your heart. Desire of your heart is this world and things in the world. You'll get that too. But that's short-lived. I'm looking to spend eternity with Jesus. I'm looking to living forever. In fact, I've been talking to him about why should I die? Why can't I be alive and kicking when you come? Somebody's not with me. You've been praying it? Why can't I be used to help close up this work? Have you been praying it? Why not? Instead of saying, well, times are going to get tough. Lord, lay me to rest. Why don't you say, Lord, put me to work? Oh, let me die. I'll die for the cause of Christ. Why don't you live for Christ? Do you see it? It's much more difficult to live for Jesus Christ than for someone to die and it's all over with. It's the test. If I'm going to repopulate heaven, dear friends, I need to be like the angels of heaven. I've got to be like Jesus. And I find character flaws still yet. But I'm longing. I'm longing for that home that I've never seen, but I've read about it. I'm desirous of that better country because I don't see anything in this life. But I see people making decisions every day that they're falling away from God rather than polarizing toward Him when we need Him the most. It's a devil's plan. He's keeping us busy even in the good things. Have you found that? It's not the rotten, dirty things out there that somebody can point a finger at. It's the good things even that He's keeping us so busy and so torn up by the time we get done with the day's activity. We're shot. No time to study, no time to pray. We're worn out. We get up, we're late in the morning, we have no time to get into the Word. The devil says, this is good, I've got them. They're mine for the day. Yeah, I'm telling you, he said, they're mine. If you have not dedicated your life to Jesus Christ before you get out of that bed or you kneel down by your bed, the devil's got you, I'm telling you right now. He's got you by the throat. Do you know that? Because he's been preparing all night long things that he can trip you up on all day. Because he's heard you talking on the phone. He's heard you making plans of what you're going to do and how you're going to do it. And he's saying, "Whoo, boy, let me see if I can't just get my hands in this just a little bit." God said this is His will, our sanctification. It has to begin in the heart. It begins a work of unholiness to a work of holiness. See, some of us, I think, sometimes we're content. We are content. Some people are at home. They're watching. They're saying, "Oh, well, this is too tough. This is too tough." It's tough because you're trying to fight the battle by yourself. If you fight it by yourself, I can say this, dear friend, you're going to lose the battle. It's outside of us, something we need outside of us has to come in and transform us into the image of Jesus Christ. And it cannot be, well, you've got a hand of the world and a hand on Jesus, and the battle goes on. Jesus said, "He who is not with me is against me." We cannot read the Scripture and the Bible says this is what God would have us to do, and we say, "Yeah, I know what He says, but I'll go ahead and do this. I'll substitute this." God does not accept substitutes. Are you with me today? Do you remember Cain and Abel? What did they do? Going to make sacrifice, wasn't it, right? Cain killed his brother Abel, didn't he? Abel made a sacrifice with blood, isn't that right? And the other put on, he was the tiller of the ground, so he put all the fruit and everything really nice and the best of everything. He said, "God will accept this because look how beautiful it is." God didn't say put the fruit on there. He said there can be no remission of sin without what? The shedding of blood. There's no remission of sin. Which pointed to Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, not an apple tree. I seen a sign this week and I liked it. Thought about going back and shaking somebody's hand I seen on that. I don't know how any of you feel about it, whatever. You know, I just say what I have in my heart sometime and you just love me anyway, isn't that right? Because, you know, people say, "Well, you know, Easter and different things are coming up and so on and so forth." On a sign out in front of a church, maybe we all put one out here. It said, "Hey, the bunny rabbit didn't die for you." Now, I like that. Somebody getting it here? The rest of them are saying, "Well, no, don't be touching on my, I like that Easter, I like that candy, I like those eggs." Hey, the rabbit didn't die for you. Isn't that right? Jesus Christ died, isn't that right? Amen. Friend, this is what it's all about. It's Jesus. We had to use our minds. Sanctification, God requires it of us. If heaven's going to be our home, God requires it. It has to come, it has to take place. It has to take place in order for us to become right with God. Because in my human nature, I'm going all the different direction. I don't know about you. I'm pulled the other way all the time. There's a constant battle that is going on. Do the wrong things. Grace. How do we experience? I found this in a little book called Testimonies, 2 Testimonies 2:63. I want to read that paragraph and see if it makes sense to you. How to experience grace. We have to have grace, is that right? If it wasn't for grace, we'd all be lost, isn't that right? The Bible says, "By grace are you saved," what? Through faith, isn't that right? So it's not by keeping 10 commandments, it's not by keeping the seventh day that you're saved, right? The Bible said, by grace are you saved through faith. But when a person is a saving relationship with Christ, they want to obey Christ, not disobey. Natural fruits of the sanctified life is lining up where Jesus said to line up. This is what it's all about. This is our test. And it'll cut across your grain of your things you like to do and I like to do. Yes. Do we love God more? Do we, you know, love ourselves? How to experience this? It starts out like this. It says, make an entire surrender to God. I can't fault this. I can't fault this. How can you experience grace? It starts out like this. Kenny, if you want to experience grace, make an entire surrender to God. Does that make sense? Make an entire surrender. See, many people surrender, but it's like the song. The song says, "All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give." I'm not made to give it. He never makes you do anything, but I freely give it to Him. I give myself. Everything was in me, my mind, my soul, my body, says everything that I freely give to You. Because I know You'll know what to do with it because it's a mess and I can't seem to do anything with it. I'm a failure. And many times we have to reach that point in our life to where we realize we are a complete failure. There's nothing that we can do within ourselves to finally we say, God, help me. Have you ever done it? Yeah. Peter was walking on the water. He was pretty confident. It's when he went under. He said, "Woo! I need some help. Somebody help me. Jesus, save me." And why is it that we have to have those experiences and go down so far before we finally look up and say, "Oh, Lord, save me. I can't do it." So first thing we do then, it has to do with the heart and the mind, is I need to surrender all to Jesus. You realize that surrender all, you husband and wife, you have to surrender your wife to God. And vice versa. And you surrender your children to God. In other words, you allow God, right, to have His will and His way. You put them on the altar. You put your job there. Everything that may be so easily beset, we put it on the altar and say, I surrender this. I surrender that I can't control my appetite. I surrender that I can't control my eyes. I can't control my mind. Lord God, I need your help. I need somebody to control this mind. I can't control my ears. I'm listening to the wrong things. The devil's taking me by my ears. Somebody's not with me. He'll take you by your ears. He'll take you by the nose. He'll take you by the eyes. Any way that he can take you, he will take you. He'll take you by the tongue. I hope somebody's listening. Somebody won't get it, but God, I can't do it. So I have to make an entire surrender. It says, yield up everything. I want to experience this grace, but I can't experience it until I've yielded up everything. Until I've yielded up temper, impatience, foul mouth, wrong thoughts. Somebody still with me? Should I go a little deeper? Maybe I've been deep enough. Some of you don't want me. You think I'm prying, right? I don't read minds. I'm not a mind reader. And don't. But you know what I'm saying? I fight the same battles that you fight. And I've lost many of them. But God's helping me to gain victory. How about you? As I submit them to Him, He's helping me. Kenny, you need to see the right things. You need to hear the right things. You need to talk to people the right way. You need to love them the way that I love you. You need to be compassionate. You need to have understanding where maybe they're weak and they fall because you've done the same thing. Don't be judgmental with them. Don't be fault-finding with them. Because I've shown you grace. And when I'm living in your heart and your mind, you need to show that grace to these other individuals. You realize how much more people would come if we quit criticizing and condemning somebody's lifestyle or what? Let Jesus work on them. Come together. Study the Word. Let the Word break down that ice, right? Melt the ice of the heart and the mind. Let Jesus come in. And you'll make that change. And you will lovingly surrender, yield up everything. And the word she uses here is unreservedly. See, I can't reserve anything for myself. Well, God, I give you everything here except. Somebody's not with me. To get to heaven, we cannot reserve one thing of this life for ourselves. Are you still with me? One little pet peeve we call, one little thing that we like. We don't have time to get into it, but maybe even next week we'll do more on it. But I think of the rich young ruler. Oh, good, all these things that I have done from my youth. You remember Jesus talking about it? Sell what you have. Give to the poor. Oh, he turned away sorrowfully. But it almost seems wonderful, great almost in our Christian experience if we could boil it down that I only have one problem. How about you? Jesus never told him, no, you have a whole lot more, son. Did he? You know, man will do that to you. You know what I'm saying? You say, well, I've only got this problem. No, you've got a whole lot more, boy. You just don't know how many you have. Jesus never called him a liar. He never said, no, you've got a whole lot more. No, you broke all of them, not just one. Say, just lack one thing. If you lack just one thing, heaven cannot be our home. If we reserve any one thing that we can't give up, heaven can't be our home. We have to give what? Unreservedly, reading on, You cannot draw nourishment, listen, from Christ unless you are in Him. Somebody stay with me. Do we all agree today that we need to draw nourishment, right? From the parent stock, isn't that right? The vine, isn't that right? He says what? He's the what? He's the vine and we are the branches. But it says there, how can we draw any nourishment if we're not fastened to Him? We claim to be. We say, well, we're a vine. We're out here, we're a vine. If we're not fastened to Him, we're a dying vine. There's no nourishment flowing through. It makes so much sense. If I am fastened to Jesus Christ, if I have a hold of His hand by faith, He's given me the nourishment I need every day. The nourishment for my mind, the nourishment for my eyes, the nourishment for my tongue. Are you still with me? He's nourishing me with His power that I may gain victory just like He did. It makes sense. How can we be conquered by the enemy if we're being nourished by Jesus? Think about it. I mean, that's quite a challenge, isn't it? How can this happen? I say I'm fastened to Jesus, but I've been talking ugly today. I'm fastened to Jesus. I'm born again, man. I'm going to heaven. But boy, we just had a fit. We just told somebody off. These people calling you on the phone all the time. Man, they're trying to get this. Somebody's blah, 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 blah. Are you fastened? Truly. And I find myself in this same boat, thrashing about at times. But the Lord keeps bringing back to my mind, if we have the mind of Christ, even though that I might be frayed a little bit because of the day's activities, I will remember that the person I'm talking to is a person that Jesus died for. He's seen something very special in them. And how would Jesus handle it? How would He deal with it? Would He be impatient? Never. Would He be unforgiving? Never. Would He be unkind? Never. Would He be unlovely? Never. But I find myself not always in that plane. I don't know about you. You have to ask yourself that. I want, by the God's grace, to make it to heaven. And I know you. Somebody needs to say amen. There's not enough amens. Now, you wanting to go to heaven or not? Praise God. All right, don't be bashful about it. God inhabits our praises. Tell God what you have need of. Isn't that right? Tell God you want to go to heaven. He knows that, but He wants you to say it. It fortifies my mind when I say, I want to go to heaven. The opposite is, well, you can have the earth. The earth was offered to Jesus. He said, I didn't want it. Mine anyway. But see, that's what the devil does. He offers you and I the things of this world to occupy us and pull us apart from Him. Well, you know, I can't observe the Sabbath because, that's my biggest day of work. Well, you're challenged with something then. You're going to serve God or you're going to serve something else? I mean, let's be honest about it. Well, I can't pay my tithe because, you're a robber and a thief and you won't go to heaven. It's that simple. We might as well get our thinking caps on. And if anybody can prove different from Scripture, it's good. I'm willing to change and say I'm sorry. But I believe that we're so close to the end of time. Please pardon me if you think I'm too blunt. I don't mean to be. I don't mean to hurt anybody, but I do want to wake people up. And it may not be anybody here. You follow me. But there's a lot of tapes that go out. And they go around the world. And there's a lot of people that's thinking, well, I want to go to heaven. I really do. But you see, they're cheating God. They're robbing God. They may be robbing God just as their presence in church service. They may be robbing Him in their time and their energy and their means. There's a lot of ways to rob God. And you know what? When we rob God, we do rob our fellow man. Do you know that? We rob our fellow man too. So we have to be fastened then to this stock. He said, you should feel an earnest desire for the Holy Spirit. We're talking about how to experience, right, grace. Then all of a sudden here, what do I need to do? I need to feel an earnest desire for the Holy Spirit. Notice this, and I should pray earnestly to obtain it. Amen. Wouldn't it be something today if we could just record how your prayer life up here on the screen, right? Pull the screen down, and we're gonna take Sister Donna. We're gonna stay with me, sister. All right. We're gonna pull this down, and I'm sure it'd be good. But let's do Brother Jacob, all right? No, it's But, you know, it would be recorded up here. Let's take my name, and my name comes up here, and you know that God has put it up here, and you see the time that I've spent talking to Him, and the time that I've spent in His Word, and the time I've spent all other places that had nothing to do with heaven or salvation or soul winning. How embarrassed some of us might be. We might be like, we talked about those men that made the accusation against the lady. You know, if our name come up, a bunch of us would be slipping out that door, wouldn't we? Well, if that's the way they're going to do, I'm not coming back. Well, that wouldn't be probably the right thing to do. But you see, we have to think in terms of how we're spending our time. Are we really praying earnestly for the power of the Holy Spirit here to obtain it? Notice this. You cannot expect a blessing of God without seeking for it. Remember, seek ye first, right? Matthew 6. Seek ye first what? The kingdom of God and His what? His righteousness and all these other things will be what? Added unto you. We're not seeking. If you're seeking Him first, the Bible says all these other things will be added unto you. Does that make sense to us? And yet when we're challenged with our job and we're challenged with our paycheck and we're challenged with insurance, we're challenged with gasoline, we're challenged on every side, we go say, oh, I want to give up. Oh, God doesn't love me anymore. No, no. That Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says God loves you with an everlasting love. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. Though a mother leave her child, I'll never. We leave Him, yes. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. If we seek His kingdom, if we seek His face, if we seek to know Him better, to love Him more, to tell others about Him. He said, all these other things I'll give you. You don't have to be all thrashing around out here. Just go do what I've asked you to do and I'll make sure. God said, some people say, well, you know, I can't pay my taxes and I can't do it. Listen, if God wants you to pay your taxes, dear friends, He might tell you to go out the lake and get that nearest fish, reach in His mouth and pull out your tax money. Somebody's not with me. Did God do it before? Yes, He did. Can He do it again? Yes, He can. I don't have any bread and water. Here come the birds. Woo! Here they come. He said, if you seek Him, seek you first the kingdom of God and His what? His righteousness and all these other things will be added. Friend, it's a guarantee. When will we apply it? When will we really, as a church, individually, when will we really accept this? Anything that keeps you away from God, you see, is going to have to be put aside. Anything that stops you from doing what you know God wants you to do, it's going to have to be put aside. Anything that's pulling us away from Christ, it has to be put aside unreservedly. You cannot expect a blessing of God without seeking for it. If you use within your means, no reach, you will experience a growth in grace. Use what you have nearest to you. If you use what God has given you, He said, you're going to start experiencing a growth in grace. See, grace is not just a word that's left over here and it always means the same and it's always the same. You know, it's growth. See, I understand grace a little bit. You understand grace. But the growth in grace is what I really need in my life right now. I need that growth, and I can't have that growth until I surrender all to Jesus Christ. You have to put the school on the back burner if that's what God wants. You have to put your job on the back burner if that's what God wants. It doesn't mean those things are wrong, but you follow me. We have to come to that point in our life to where anything that would separate us from God, we have to put on the back burner and say, what's over here? Because I want that growth in what? In grace. And it says, if we do that, we will rise to a higher life. I want to rise to a higher life. How about you? I'm wanting to attain that which God has in mind for me today. But it's after I put Him first, after I seek Him with all my heart. Oh, friend, that's quite a challenge. For I know this about you, and I know this about me. And if I'm wrong, you correct me. You correct me if I'm wrong on this. It's not natural for us to love spiritual things. Somebody talk to me. It's true, isn't it? It's not natural. It's not natural for us to love spiritual things. But you can acquire that relationship. You can acquire that kind of love by exercising your mind. Are you still there? And strength and your being in that direction. So it's not natural for me to love the good things or be what Jesus wants me to be, but I can get that way by exercising my mind, right? When things are, be determined by the grace of God and say, God, help me. It's important that we do that. I read just a little, a couple of lines there on a letter that was written in 1897. I thought it was very nice in studying. It says, the more that a heart is wrapped up in Christ, the more secure is our treasure in the eternal world. But how awesome. Did anybody get that? The more that the heart is wrapped up in Christ, the more that the heart is what? Wrapped up in Christ, the more secure our treasure is in the eternal world to come. Now think about it. So it says that we need to be wrapped up in who? In Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. How can this sinful man be transformed? And we must realize that transformation can not come about except it been for Jesus Christ and the cross of Calvary. It could never take place. Let's not disappoint him. Our time's already gone. We're not even scratching the surface. We haven't talked about so many other things here that God requires of us. But what we don't need to disappoint him today, do we? I want to be transformed by God's grace. How about you? It's needful if heaven's going to be my home. But I can't hold on to one cherished idol or theme because it will surely separate me from God. And so today I need to surrender all to Him. Maybe today you need to surrender all to Him. And you're going to let Him. You're going to turn things over to Him. Isn't that right? See, we need not be afraid to turn everything over to God. Rather, what we do, we say, if I turn all these things in, oh, it's going to come on my shoulder. Friend, get yourself out of the equation here. Get yourself out of the picture. If you make a decision for Jesus, that means he's going to take your whatever you have going, and He's going to take it, right? Whatever issues you may have, He's going to take those issues. And He's going to be responsible and accountable for meeting your needs, the things that you have, a need of a new heart, need of a new mind. Maybe material thing. God knows all these things. But you have to be willing, friends. Is there anyone willing today? I want to start by that. I need to be transformed by God's grace. I want heaven to be my home, and I don't want anything. I mean anything to stand in the way of that. Everything else is folly. Do we understand that today before we close? Do we understand everything else is folly? It's so short-lived. And some of the younger people have a hard time with that. If the world should last, you'll see how fast you age. And it's just like yesterday, you were 20 or you were 30 and no longer that way anymore. And then what? We're living in the judgment hour. We have been since 1844. We all know that. We should know that. The hour of probation. And you know what? There's very few people giving that message for today. If you really believe that Jesus was coming in the clouds of glory, you should be hearing that message. You know that? That we're living in the judgment hour. We've been for a lot of years now. That's proven in Scripture beyond a shadow of a doubt. And that probation is soon to close one of these days. And when it does, boom, that's it. Not another person will ever come to Christ. So today's the day of salvation, isn't it? Friend, you want that sanctification experience with Jesus in a more real way than before? You want that growth in grace? It begins where? In the heart. And we need to be wrapped up in Jesus today. So I invite you to wrap yourself in Jesus today. And you can do that by saying, Lord, I surrender all. I hold back nothing. Where I'm weak, maybe where I'm doing wrong, I ask that you would strengthen me, that I may be more than a conqueror through Him. Is there anyone that will raise their hand with me and make that commitment? I make that commitment to all of heaven that, you know, I'm surrendering all to Jesus. Praise the Lord. That's right. The angels of heaven love to see your hands. Thank God. That's right. You're surrendering to Jesus Christ. Friends, if you don't surrender to Jesus Christ, you've surrendered to the devil. It's one foe or the other, isn't it? So praise God for the hands and for the heart. God knows what you're thinking. He knows what you have need of before you ask. And He says, I'm going to meet that need. But you're going to have to put forth a personal effort. Because you're in the struggle for your very life, for eternity. And you've renewed that commitment or maybe made that commitment to Him, maybe for the first time. And remember, whatever it takes that I can spend eternity with Jesus, let it happen in my life. Because I trust You and because I love You. Let's pray, shall we? Let's kneel together. Merciful Father in heaven, we thank You for Your word today. Thank You for reminding us that You're our Lord and our Savior. You're our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer. There's nothing good within us. Today You offer each and every one of us Your merits. And without those merits, we will never spend eternity with You. We have to be emptied of self. We are desirous of Thy Holy Spirit now coming into our hearts and our lives for every hand that was raised up. That every time the enemy comes against us and challenges us with whatever the situation may be, we're going to realize You said in Your word, Lord, You would never leave me. If you said in Your word, if I seek You first, the kingdom of God, all these other things will be added unto me. God likes to hear His word quoted back to Him. It's a promise. And He always honors it. And so, Lord, I pray that You'll give each one the desire of their heart today. They want to grow in grace and in sanctification. And I pray this week will be a different week than last week. We'll see Your grace. We'll understand it. We'll experience it. Others will see it. Others will see that Jesus lives in our hearts. We're not going to be hasty with our temper anymore, with our tongue. We're going to be patient. We're going to be kind because Jesus is living in our heart. And if the enemy comes against and we feel ourselves going the other way, all we have to do is dart a prayer to heaven quickly and say, God, help me. And the Lord never fails. Bless now, we pray, as the hands that were raised and the hearts. And Lord, I pray that each one day, will be able to see You coming in the clouds of glory. We can spend eternity with You. That's all that's important. This life is just a fleeting moment. It's gone. And Lord, we want to see You come in the clouds of glory. Until that day, help us to occupy. Help us to be faithful. Help us moment by moment to surrender our hearts and lives to You. And one day we'll see You coming in the clouds of glory. This is our prayer. This is our delight. This is our hope. As we thank You in Jesus' name. Amen.